Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. With me today is Imani Cruzen, my co-host. And your guest today is Imani?
My guest today is Aaron Westendorp. He's been a DJ with KFAI for a few years, and he's also being profiled in a documentary.
Coming up later in the show will be Chris Sayers from the Star Tribune talking about a recent article he did on giving the COVID shots to people with Down syndrome, so it should be pretty interesting.
I think that all sounds really interesting.
Sounds good, and we got a half hour to do it, so Disability Viewpoints is coming up next. Stay tuned.
Today, my guest is Aaron Westendorp, who has worked as a DJ with KFAI and who has also been profiled in a documentary that will be premiering at a later date. So nice to see you, Aaron. Could you start with introducing yourself to our viewers?
Hey, nice to be here finally. And I promise I won't swear. Well, my name is Aaron, and I am known to be a nonverbal loudmouth. Let's just say my insult comedy is very well known. I am a radio DJ and producer. I write, produce, and host my own music show on KFAI, 90.3 FM and KFAI.org. If you know Sam Jasmine's show, Disability and Progress, I am on the same station as that. I actually help Sam edit her show into podcast form as well. I am a percussionist with several local groups and a humanitarian who loves reaching out to others in a twisted way.
Well, great. Thank you for that intro. And could you tell me about your experience with KFAI and how you got involved as a DJ?
My very first experience with KFAI was in high school. I had a very hip bus driver, and on the way home he used to tune into the KFAI afternoon drive time blues shows. And I remember one time, to celebrate the birthday of Aretha Franklin, the DJ played five or six songs of hers in a row. A DJ by the name of Pete Lee, who still is on to this very day and who has influenced my show very much. And I was like, I really love this station. So one night in 2003, I boarded the school bus as per usual. And I remember the newscaster for KFAI crying hard, announcing the death of one of these afternoon blues program hosts by the name of Joel Johnson. And I remember thinking, this is a radio community that cares for each other deeply. So I went down that night to see how I could volunteer, and they said, oh, come back on Thursday, we're having a volunteer orientation. So I did, and they put me on card crew, which is where they edit all the on-air promotional spots. I hung out there for a while, and then I took the board certification course they had there, which you have to take in order to get on the air there. And then I volunteered to watch the controls when they were running the national syndicated news show Democracy Now! And then, the news director at the time, by the name of Dale Connolly, got the bright idea to have me gather and read the top of the hour news on Fridays. Then they decided to discontinue that. I also did a news internship at KFAI, where I produced a few news stories, as well as edited audio for other people's stories for their morning drive show there. Around that time, They were looking for new hosts for shows, and I applied and got a web-only show, which is basically a podcast. So I made shows for a few months, and then I ended up in the hospital. The show was put on hiatus, and I only started up again 2 years ago last month, just because of life. And honestly, lack of motivation, but I am glad I started up again.
Okay. Well, I know you talked a little bit about some of your inspiration, but could you tell me a little bit more about what your style is like as a DJ, and could you tell us about your show and what some of its other inspiration has been?
My DJ style for my show, which, by the way, is named Aaron's Cavalcade of Whimsy, which I think is the most pompous name I can give a radio show. I didn't even come up with it. You can find it on mixcloud.com/Aaron-Westendorp. The style I think I use the most is called Freeform, which I picked up from other radio programmers. And that's the way to do it. If you want to be on the air, get some inspiration from hosts that have been in the business for years. Freeform means you have total control of the content of your show, within FCC limits, of course, and I do theme sets, which is where you build up a list of songs revolving around a phrase or artist. So maybe you play an artist, then you follow that song up with a cover of another song by the same artist. It's actually quite fun to do. And if you are not knowledgeable about an artist, Google is your friend and you can sprinkle useless trivia facts, like Casey Kasem did back in the day, throughout the show. So, that's how a normal episode of my show usually goes. Plus there's months I do whole theme shows. Like 1 month last year I did a whole Wizard of Oz show. That was fun. So there's what the Cavalcade is about. Right now I am actually working on a show all about the weirdness that is Disney, and it has been a fun show to put together.
Yeah, and you've also been profiled in a documentary, so could you tell me more about that?
Yes, I am going to be in a documentary that has been many years in the making, because if I am involved, it will be over budget and over schedule. Let's be honest, and the pandemic didn't help things. Basically, it's a look into my life, my humor. It shows my many sides, from volunteering at KFAI, to playing in the legendary Johnny Holm Band, to being in the Minneapolis May Day Parade and Ceremony each year, to trading insults with Garrison Keillor. I mean, it's a real look at how active I am. And of special interest for regular SPNN viewers out there, Amy Goodman, of Democracy Now!, which airs twice daily on here, I believe, makes an appearance. And maybe you saw it in the trailer already, but she was asked how she would describe me, and her reply was incredibly warm but also insulting. Imani can vouch for this. I call her the third sister I never had because we bicker so much, but it's all out of love.
Yes, definitely. And why were you interested in taking part in this documentary?
I think this documentary shows how rich a life a person with a disability can live if they have the spirit and the means, and the opportunity. I often consider myself the exception to the rule. And what I mean by that is, some people, I think, consider people with disabilities stuck in their houses, in group homes, unable to do much. And before the pandemic hit, I was the opposite, going downtown on Saturday nights to go to the gay 90s to hang with the drag queens, or go see cover bands I befriended at Cowboy Jack's, or go see Johnny Holm and his band, and do percussion with them, which was on a fairly regular basis before everything changed. So I am active, and I go to places where I don't see many physically disabled people there to be a part of community. And that's my mission in life, to build community and friendships. I have not always been successful, but you know, it's a blessed life.
Yeah, and how can someone learn more about this documentary?
Well, right now, we have a Facebook event page for the premiere, which, of course, is still up in the air due to everything happening. But I can send you the link. You can post it on your Facebook page.
Okay, thank you. Is there anything else you would like to add, Aaron?
I just want to say thank you for having me on. It was really nice to be on this show finally. So thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you for coming on. I really appreciate it. So I'm glad we were able to hear more about both your DJing and your documentary.
Aaron? You mean other than as a small-time criminal?
He's always been very determined.
Describe him, not in a few words. I can't.
I guess my one word might be musical.
He's a prolific dancer.
A little dramatic.
Very goofy, yes.
He's smart as hell.
Incredibly warm and also insulting.
He's one of the nicest guys I know.
Flirtatious.
Kind of grows on you.
Like foot fungus, yeah.
I think Aaron is exceptionally kind.
Sarcastic.
This killer sense of humor, this guy.
He's one of our prime characters here at KFAI.
I want you to meet Krista and Doug Westendorp. Your little boy was not born healthy. What was the problem?
Well, he was born with multiple neurologic handicaps.
The doctor said he wasn't going to live, and they said,
it's better for everyone if you just let him go.
We were advised not to take him home. It'll be the end of your family, the end of your marriage. He's not going to survive anyway.
And my parents were, I think, taking cues directly from Aaron and feeling like, that's not what he wants. He wants us to fight for him.
My name is Aaron. I am that kid. You're listening to Fresh Air Community Radio, KFAI, 90.3 FM, Minneapolis. I am Aaron Westendorp.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. My special guest today, and he is special, is Chris Sears from the Minneapolis Star Tribune. And we hope you read that paper every day because it's available and he's got a lot of good things in there. Today we're talking about a most recent story on the COVID-19 vaccine and Down syndrome people. And so, Chris, I'll let you take it away from here. Welcome to the show.
Well, thanks a lot, Mark, for having me on your show. And you know, the vaccine program that the state launched a couple months ago, got off to a pretty quick start. And there's growing concern, though, that people with disabilities haven't been represented in the priority plan, right?
Right.
So they got out and they started vaccinating primarily people that were over the age of 65, seniors. Which made some sense because data showed that about 90% of the people that are dying from COVID thus far are over the age of 65. So that made sense, right? The purpose of the vaccine program is you're trying to prevent deaths. You're trying to prevent harm.
Right.
Well, the next stage was up the vaccine program to a broader group of people that included healthcare workers, it included childcare workers, it included teachers. So all of a sudden, we have hundreds of thousands of people that are getting the vaccine who are younger, who are healthier. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we have a whole large population of people with significant developmental disabilities, mm-hmm. in some cases, serious health conditions that are being ignored. And that's kind of what we wrote about was, and a subset of that would be people with Down syndrome, where I didn't realize this until a couple weeks ago, but people with Down syndrome are 10 times as likely to die from this virus than the general population. You know, they're 4 times as likely to be hospitalized for a variety of reasons, but mostly they have weaker immune systems than the rest of us do. So if the point of the vaccination program is to prevent deaths, is to focus on those who are most likely to die from this, then you would think 2 months into this program that there would be some priority for people like those with Down syndrome. I think there's about 5,000 people across the state with Down syndrome. And so a number of advocacy groups, including the state Down Syndrome Association, have really been pushing hard on this. They've been writing letters to the governor, to the state health commissioner, and they really haven't gotten a very robust response. And it's disconcerting to say the least. If the vaccine program is to prevent people from dying, then one would think that they would use science to really try to focus on people like those with Down syndrome.
Yeah, there's some groups out there that are really watching this. And I think your article was well done. And I think there's more of a reply that is needed at this point.
Well, thanks for saying that. We do keep hearing the same refrain from the state, which is, you know, we don't have enough vaccines to go around.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't. And, you know, there's a limited supply. There's a huge demand.
Mm-hmm.
Still, recognizing that fact, one wonders why it is that we have healthy school teachers getting the vaccine, in some cases ahead of people with Down.
Yep, no, absolutely. I totally agree. Have you talked to Jan Malcolm and folks like that?
Well, we've talked to people at the health department repeatedly about issues around the vaccine, including mm-hmm. this issue. And, you know, really what they've continued to say is, you know, we're going to get to those folks. Be patient. We don't have enough vaccines to go around. And they're going to be, I think, in the coming weeks, announcing the next priority stages.
Mm-hmm.
We really don't know what that's going to look like. One would hope that it would include people with significant developmental disabilities, people with Down syndrome, people with serious underlying health conditions. I mean, we have a whole population of folks that, I've heard from people that have had organ transplants,
right,
and they haven't been able to get a vaccine. If the goal of all this is to prevent deaths, then there really should be a focus on those who are most vulnerable.
Then the same question can be said for all these groups. The same argument can be said that why weren't they first?
To give the Department of Health some credit, I mean, they really had a huge burden here to get the vaccine into people's arms quickly. And to focus on seniors out of the gate made some sense because, they comprise the bulk of those who have been dying from this horrible disease. And getting out to nursing homes and assisted living facilities was easier to do than getting people to come in to clinics. So it made some sense early on, but now that we're, entering the second month of this program, one would hope that they would start to think about some of these forgotten populations and kind of rethink the strategy a bit.
The other problem we really have in the state that our state administrators blame the federal people. The federal people are waiting for the shots and they're not distributed fast enough. I mean, it's like a three-ring circus.
Well, the bottom line is the federal guidance is just guidance. That's all it is. Yeah. We've seen other states like Texas and Tennessee and Vermont and Ohio leap ahead of Minnesota in prioritizing people with intellectual and developmental disabilities.
Right.
In fact, they've already put them on the priority list. There are people with Down syndrome in other states that are already getting the vaccine. In Minnesota, we just haven't taken that step yet. But we have a great deal of flexibility to roll out the program as we see fit. So to blame the feds really is not credible.
And I just find it interesting, you know, that if you don't know a concrete answer, you know, play the blame game, you know.
Right, right. I don't think that's going to work, and I think it it doesn't sit well with people with disabilities. I think another disparity we're seeing is that the initial focus of the vaccine program was primarily based on age. We talked about that, but also based on where people live. Mm-hmm. People who live in congregate settings, mm-hmm. that includes nursing homes or group homes, you know, four-bedroom group homes, they were prioritized for the vaccine. But people who live in their own homes were not. So there's some sense behind that because people who live in congregate settings are more at risk. On the other hand, again, if you have, two seniors with someone at home, a child with Down syndrome, who's 45 years old, that's a pretty risky scenario. One could argue it's more risky than living in a group home.
All right.
And so to have a situation where someone is penalized for living in their own home and for caring for their own family members, I think is fundamentally unfair.
Well, I think we've seen the wheels in motion move forward, and that is that the assisted livings and all these places are getting their vaccines now. So they're kind of getting ready to see their families, whom they haven't seen in a long time, probably. And that's kind of the good thing of it. It took a long time to get to that. So when you hear on the news, boy, I sure would like to see my family, or I miss my family, it's the absolute truth. I can relate.
Yeah, I can relate too. I mean, I've got two parents that are you know, over the age of 70. So I really want to see them get the vaccine. But the gains that have been made in assisted living and nursing homes are real. We've seen the case numbers of infections plunged by 90% since mid-November. Mm-hmm. I mean, they've just gone down. And not all of that is due to the vaccine, but some of it is related to the fact that they're getting shots in their arm. You know, even the first shot of the vaccine can provide 50 to 80% protection against the virus. So even if you get one shot, it has a huge difference in terms of saving people's lives. So again, I think the gains in long-term care are huge, and the state deserves credit for that.
Right.
But there's this whole other population of people out there who live in their own homes, people with Down syndrome, who are also at risk, and at significant risk. And I just think it's important that they are prioritized.
My question is, if you can still hear me, what is the new normal going to really look like? That's going to be the next thing. What is normal going to be?
What I would hope the new normal is that we rethink how we provide care to people with in their own homes. Mm-hmm. I really hope that's the new normal, and there's more of a focus on care. I personally think that for the past year there's been too much of a focus on containment.
Right.
Mask wearing and vaccine, and I mean, that stuff's important, but what's really important, you know, and we learned this through the HIV/AIDS crisis in the 1980s, was what's really important is care and providing communities of care for people, especially in their own homes.
And if Absolutely. We learned
anything from this, is that we have to be on this fragmented medical system and get care to where people live in the settings where they live and really focus on that, because you know there are going to be other variants of this virus, and the vaccines are only going to go so far. So this is going to be with us.
Absolutely.
Right. We should figure out a way that if somebody finds out that they have this, that they know this is what's going to happen. This is the kind of care that's going to be provided for me to protect me and my family.
Exactly.
So you asked me what the new normal would be. That's what I would hope the new normal is.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's the new normal, but that's what I would hope it would be. And I hope we get beyond all of this stupid political bickering about wearing masks.
I do too. Again, our guest, very special guest today has been Chris Sears from the Minneapolis Star Tribune. I hope you'll read that paper 7 days a week, but follow his articles because this has been a very special one on COVID-19 vaccinations for people with Down syndrome. And we'll be back with more disability viewpoints in just a moment.
Imani, that was a great interview you had, and all in all, it was a great show. And we hope the viewers at home learned something, because I think we did too.
Yeah, I agree, definitely.
Chris Sears, as I said before, did a recent article in the Star Tribune about giving shots to the COVID with people with Down syndrome, and he had a lot of details there and a lot of good insight on his information. Any final thoughts before we go, Imani?
It was really nice having Aaron on and being able to talk with him about some of his inspiration for his work as a DJ and also to hear about the documentary he's being profiled in.
That was a great interview, and I think mine was informative too. We try to make it that. And we thank the viewers at home for watching, and again for Imani Cruzen coming out today to be our co-host. We'll hope you join us next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.